This is a crowded race. There's a lot of candidates in this race, and everybody has their own reasons for running for public office. But what was yours? What was your decision? Why did you make the decision you wanted to run for city council in this district in this election?
Well, I've lived in a city council district 15 my whole life. And as a board member on Community Board 11, there have been many issues that we have dealt with on a daily basis, have been brought to the community board, so I'm very well aware. And I wanted to take these voicings and concerns to a different level. I want to represent the constituents of City Council District 15 to overcome political and systemic challenges that are getting in the way of economic stability, good schools, neighborhood amenities, and safe streets. I want to bring the commitment and dedication that I bring to my community through my community leadership and advocacy. I want to take it to a different level where there's actually could be movement in that direction, moving forward in that direction.
And Bernadette, with the candidates that are on this ballot, there's such a varying level of experience when it comes to dealing with issues in the community and just, you know, having some ideas as far as how what they want to do in the community. You have worked in the community, as you said, in various different forms, work on different causes. How does that experience, do you think, make you a better choice than some of the candidates that are on the ballot right now for city council?
The experience is priceless. Many people who are constituents don't realize that they do have a voice, that they need to have their community represented. Many people are not aware about a community board or bringing things to committee level. I've sat on the Housing Committee, the Economic Development Committee. I've been to many, many land use. Land use is a major, major issue, zoning, et cetera. It could change the landscape of a community in a heartbeat. We all know that. And I've sat on the youth and education, and that has been one of my priorities since I've been on the community board for 12 years and running, because that's our future. That's the future of our of what's going to be in our communities. That's the products that we're going to reap what we sow there. So that is foundational. That's important.
Absolutely. And you know, as you mentioned, you're out in the community, you're talking to a lot of the constituents, you have an idea of what really matters to the people in the district. So with that in mind, what, in your opinion, from what you've heard from people, is the biggest issue facing people in this district?
Well, sometimes it gets very simple. And as being a constituent myself, my first thing is, I don't know what your party is running on, but what are you going to do for me? What are you going to do in my daily life? How are you going to make my walk outside of my threshold of where I live positive? How are my jobs going to be better? What about the schools that my children are going to? How do I get them to be in my community? I don't want to put my child on a bus and take them outside of their community where I have to go to work or I have to deal with situations at home and I'm not there. I'm not close by. What are their curriculums? What are they being taught in school? How do you get, these are all things that come to me. They go, what about me, my life? How are you going to affect the things that matter to me on a daily basis? I get that all the time. And I go, I hear you, because I ask the same questions. And that's why taking things to this level, take it beyond the volunteer level where you're begging for community amenities. We're begging for a community center. It's been decades since I grew up here in the community. We don't have one. Why? I can't get an answer. How do we start that forward, that process? I have parents that say, I can't afford Bronx House or, summer school. How do I get one in my community that I could walk my kids there? I could feel safe that they're close to home. I know that while I'm at work or if I'm dealing with an issue, I can actually have my kids go to a summer camp that's affordable. So I hear it every day.
There's a lot of issues there. And a lot of people, people have a lot, especially the pandemic has just accentuated a lot of these issues right now. And, yes. As we've been talking about, with this particular election, whoever wins this month is getting thrown right into city council, right into the middle of this pandemic for the remainder of the year, at least.
Yes.
what would you want to tackle first? What would you feel would be the most important thing to address first when it comes to the pandemic and recovery and getting people back to some semblance of a normal life?
Well, we have to, a priority is our children. Our children. The schools need to open, and they need to be dealing with whatever the pandemic has thrown in our path, our safeguards, etc. But they need to go back to school. You have so many children, especially in District 15, which is the highest in poverty, that don't have all of, they're sharing computers at home. They're sharing them with a family member that maybe is working at home. They're sharing with a sibling. They, you have 5-year-olds that have attention spans of a flea. And they're like, how do I go to here? And I do this, et cetera. They might not have their teachers right there directing them. And if they do, their parents need to jump in and be an assistant, a teacher's assistant with their children. And parents want to do that, but maybe they're working on another computer. And so they need, these children need to go back to school. It needs to be addressed how this has to happen. There are kids that are going to be losing a year of school, maybe have to repeat it again, which is a tough thing to address. If it needs be, then it needs to. And if I was a parent, I'd be very upset about it, but have to look into the importance of it. And even in regular school years, I know that if the children are not are failing or not up to par, parents don't mind having them repeat the year. But it does deal with this on a social level with the children. That's number one. And the other thing is the small businesses. They are the backbone of most of our neighborhoods. They need to have relief from pandemic violations that they get that burden of financial problem. Why is there no leniency? Why has that not been looked into? I don't understand. To me, it's like a no-brainer. So, there's so many other things.
Oh, no, absolutely. And you know, on that small business front, you know, because you mentioned it right there, you know, we're seeing two problems really coming out of this, whether it be the empty storefronts that we're now being left with all these businesses have had to close, and then the businesses that have somehow managed to stay open but are really struggling and not sure when any kind of relief is going to come. How do you help them? How do you address that? Is there any way that you can help them to either reopen or just stay open?
Well, you have to respond to the colleagues in city council. You have to basically saying, okay, we need to deal with this directly. We need to bring it up at every city council meeting and say, what about the small businesses? I sit on the board of the Morris Park Business District on the bid. I hear what they have. I'm a non-voter because I don't own a business, but I represent my community. And I want to be there for the board meetings. I want to hear what's going on. I want to know what resources come to their rescue and why. Are those resources enough? I'm seeing that it's not. Businesses that have been in our community for decades are shuttering. And it is so heartbreaking. It makes my heart very, very heavy. I know a lot of these businesses. They know Van Ness, they know Morris Park, and they just can't do it. Their life savings are drained. They're not getting these loans, or maybe small percentage loans, but they're not money that's given to them. They have to pay that back. What happens if they can't pay that back? They're making decisions based on that. And that is very sad. It's very sad for the community. It's sad for them. Decades long businesses that have closed, and it's a turning of the page, and it's very sad.
And it is. And another issue that we've seen come up during this pandemic over the course has been the role of the police here and the role in as far as public safety here in the district is concerned. Obviously, you know, everybody always talks about, like we were talking about, education, small businesses, pandemic recovery, very important, but everybody also wants to feel safe in their community.
Yes.
What are your thoughts regarding, you know, ensuring public safety here in District 15 and your feeling as what the role that the NYPD should play in that?
Well, I would say the public safety is a major issue. I speak to a lot of disabled veterans, a lot of disabled constituents, and a lot of disabled seniors, period. And I have a very, very soft spot in my heart for that, because they don't come out of their houses. I'm sorry. I've done a lot of door knocking. I'm still doing, I will be doing door knocking when I finish this interview. And I listen and I go, you know what? You get me in there. I will focus on this, because we have a senior housing here, and I know all of those seniors. My father lived in the Monsignor Fiorentina senior apartments. They are such wonderful people. They are actively voting. They want to know what's going on in the community, but they're not going to, you know, if it's not 3 o'clock in the afternoon, et cetera, or if they feel a little unstable, they're not going to go out. They have to find somebody to help them. And they feel very unsafe. And it's a very sad day when that is a forefront in their minds, in anybody's mind. I mean, I'm a senior myself, and we've just had an incident just recently where early 60s, somebody was walking home from East Tremont, and somebody tapped them on the shoulder and was asking directions and immediately slashed their face. And this is a female that was not feeble and was 60 years old and was just walking home from the train station. So you know what, when it comes to public safety, this is a major issue. What are the police? I feel, as far as their role, I think that they need to be given more money. They need to have more police on the beat. They need to, people ask me, what happened to the beat cops? Where are they? We feel so safe, even though we have NYPD cameras in many hotspot areas. People don't feel safe with those cameras as much as they would see in the presence of the police. I keep on asking, we have a very, I believe in a real partnership with the NYPD and for us in Community Board 11 and in Van Ness, and it's something that I will nurture and get put deep roots in all over District 15, is a good partnership with the NYPD, whatever your precinct is, okay? NCOs, 49 precinct council meetings, having a hotline to the police with text chats. I don't know who's on duty, but we came up with a solution that seemed to be working, that we want to know if there's an issue going on. We send out a blast to everybody. Whoever is on duty responds. And it's something that has been working, makes people feel that there's a response. I feel that a lot about the budget with the NYPD is being looked at. So if the budget needs to be reallocated, where's the money going? Could it be trimmed over here to put more stuff here? Where's our funding for our youth explorers? That needs to be expanded. We have youth officers. They need to be out in the community more. We were spoiled with some of our youth officers of a couple of years ago that were out there just talking to kids that are hanging out, whether it be at the park or at the corner, telling them what's available. Are some of you interested? You know, making it just on a one-on-one level. We're not getting that. We need to come back to that. And a lot of it is because there needs to be more police doing it. There needs to be more funding with training. I mean, I have an autistic brother, okay, a severely autistic brother. He's my baby brother. He's in a group home. I want to know that if the police, if something should happen with him, that he comes with an altercation with the officer, that they could recognize cognitive issues. Okay, because number one, he will shut down. He will not be responsive to immediate issues that say, hey, you know, what's your name? Stop doing this. What's going on? He can't cognitively respond. I want to know that the officers have that training. I want to know that they could see EDPs. So there's a lot that could be looked at. And as far as this, I have to point out one thing. One of the candidates say to demilitarize the police. First of all, yes, they get their firearms donated from the Department of Defense. But on the local precinct level, they do not have the high-end militia that seems to be brought out. And there's a lot of good studies, Princeton studies, that basically broaden that horizons of facts. So there's a lot to be looked at.
Absolutely. And there's a lot to be looked at when it comes to another issue that I feel always seems to come up and has come up a lot over the last couple of years, and that's housing. And that is something that no matter when you talk to or who you talk to, it always seems to come up that people either can't afford to live here, or the rent is going too high, or whatever the issue may be, or even the quality of the housing that we currently have, whether you're talking about NYCHA or other public housing. What are your thoughts on the housing issues here in the district? Is it a housing crisis in your opinion? And what can we do about it moving forward? And what would you do about it from City Council?
Housing is a crisis, whether it be on the NYCHA level or whether it be within absentee negligent landlords with in community, in different communities. But in District 15, there's 2,150 NYCHA developments, okay, NYCHA housing. Those are systems, okay? That's a public housing system. That's a systemic challenge that really, to be quite honest, should have not been put a Band-Aid on, should have been addressed, especially with the falsified lead paint inspections that were brought to light. I mean, that's just a tip of the iceberg. The NYCHA houses have been around for a long time. They have been on the city's agenda for a long time. That should have been dealt with before our mayor decided to do all of the allocations for affordable housings. This mayor wanted to have a one size fit all with the affordable housing. Came in front of Community Board 11, as it did the other 11, all 12 community boards and community boards in the Bronx. All 12 rejected it. They rejected it because it's not a one size fits all. Each fabric of each community holds its own characteristic. Zoning is a big issue. It's not a one size fits all thing. It could, there are communities and the fabrics of the characteristics of those communities needs to be looked into. The medium income needs to be looked at. The mayor didn't want to look at that. He basically said, thank you, community boards, but I'm going to go ahead anyway. It's in print. So, before that project should have been undertaken, it should have been looked at the NYCHA houses, because what they are dealing with on a daily level is just, it's really atrocious. It's really sad. People should live there for a month and basically from their experience say, no can do. And they're not. I know Councilman Torres has really brought this to light, and I'm so grateful to him for that. And anybody that gets elected is going to have to fill some pretty big shoes with that. I mean, he was the head of the oversight committee, that an investigation committee that I would like to be saying, hey, that's what I want to do, because I would like to really dig in and see what's going on, especially with housing. And I feel that the absentee and negligent landlords, that they do not, they bring into communities, the people that they do not screen, okay, for whatever, there's a lot of screening process, and a lot of them do not do that, and it destabilizes communities in a great way. And then the communities have to deal with it. And honestly, that we've dealt with that quite a bit in the Van Ness community and Community Board 11. So there's a lot to be looked at, and I will hit the road running, because I'm like, yeah, bring it over. I'll check it out. I'll want to know what's going on. I will dig deep.
Bernadette, I feel like we could talk about several other issues here, and I know we're both probably running a little low on time here, but I'll just get to one more real quick before we start to wrap up here, and that's the public transportation system and improving the access to public transportation for people here in the district, whether we're talking about buses or subways or MTA, whatever it may be. How important is that to the people here in the district, and what would you like to see done to improve that?
Well, I think that, well, first of all, getting the MTA system, it's 100 years old and running. It needs to be looked at. I know the improvements in the past years have been great. I have been riding the subway since I'm 17 years old, up until last year. I am a subway baby. And a lot of people in my community, besides riding the subway to get to work, they take the express buses that go into Manhattan. They take the Metro North to go to places of work in Connecticut. They go to different areas. They go to New Jersey. They'll get in their cars. They have to go over the bridge, wherever work is going to take them. But the MTA needs to be looked at, especially with the pandemic now. People are going to This has been argued in past forums. I'm sorry. People are buying, they are buying cars. They are leasing cars because you can, it's more affordable now to lease a car as it is to finance it. My preference is to finance, but you know, that's a big finance every month and I have to choose what I'm paying for. Groceries, car. I'd rather have my car because my groceries are a little bit less, you know, but there are so many ways. And I know that what is being brought up is also other kinds of ways. You got the scooters, you got the e-bikes, you got, and while that is good for a small targeted group of people, you're going to get a lot of people that say, I have a family. I can't get on the scooter with a family. I need a car. I have my stroller, my stuff for my children. I have to get to work. I have to drop off the job, whatever. So cars are still a large element to get to work. But the subway system will always be a major thing, but it cannot be the only thing. There have been a large people that take the express buses into work every day. They've been doing it for decades. They have been doing it for decades. That is not going to stop. So we need to look at that. And here, right here in District 15, we have the Cross Bronx Expressway. That is total accessibility. I could get into Manhattan on the east side in 20 minutes, on the west side, 25 minutes. I could go down and get through the tunnel. I can get into Brooklyn. I could go to Jersey. I could get anywhere I want in a heartbeat. All right. And that is one of the great points of living in District 15. So when you're talking about the Cross Bronx Expressway, that is a big issue because that is the number one worst highway in the country. But some of these pie in the sky attitudes or ideas that are coming up, I agree that we should always look beyond and dream, but they're not practical and they will cause other health issues. So there's a lot to look at. And hey, let's come to the table. Let's talk about things. Let's find practical and common sense solutions, not ones that cannot be enacted in our lifetime.
Good ideas. Good point, Bernard. Absolutely. All right, two nice things for you here. First thing, let's have a little bit of fun here because I want to know something about you.
That,
all right. What is a fun fact, something about you that people may not know? Something, whether it be a hobby or a story or something that people may not know about you that I think people might want to know?
Well, let's see, what can I pick from? Okay, one of my first passions have always been animal rescue, all right? Before I even became part of Community Board 11, before I was appointed, before I even knew about our local civic association, I was doing animal rescue. And in 2000, I was probably one of the first people to pioneer in the Bronx, along with a few animal advocates, for the Bronx having a Bronx animal shelter. Because that was taken away in 1994 when ACC came in and ASPCA was not the charity. So they had to have something, so ACC came in. But they never put a local shelter where they tore the other one down. I went there as a kid and I was like, what is going on? So dug into that, advocated for that, and still advocated up until the day where we did get the allocation for funds for the spot in Bay Plaza for the Bronx Animal Shelter with the mayor. So that is like, I could just say thank you to everybody who did that. But that was one of the things I was like, I went to all the city council. I testified at city council meetings. I went to the ACC annual public meetings that they had. I tried to let everybody know that Intro 655 was basically going to become Local Law 59. If we don't do something with city council, it cannot be reverted. And we will not have our animal shelter. Hence, Local 59, that became law. So animal rescue, educating for both sides, for the health of the animal, and also for property owners, management owners. There are so many ways that we could partner. So I still do that. I just did it yesterday. So, I'm also
an artist. How many cats do you have? Because we've seen one walking by.
I have six. I have six cats at this point. Yes, and about four of them are major seniors that will be going over the Rainbow Bridge soon because they never got adopted. So they all live in harmony. It's amazing.
Very nice.
I just did an animal rescue last week. I said, people look at me and I'm always having my traps, and I will help people. I will do whatever I can. I'm a certified animal rescuer. We get appointments, not public calendar. And anybody that wants to do community rescue, community service, and you don't know where to start and you love animals, start there.
Good advice. It's free.
The workshops are free.
Bernadette, I'm going to let you get back to knocking on doors in just a minute, but last thing for you here, we've got so many candidates on this ballot. This is also a ranked choice voting election now, so people are going to get a chance to vote for more than one candidate on their ballots. What do you want people to remember about you and have in the back of their head when they fill out their ballot, so that when they see your name on the ballot, they want to fill out that bubble next to your name? What do you want them to remember about you?
I want them to remember the commitment and dedication that I've brought to my community, that I will bring to city council. I will fight. I will voice my opinion. And if anybody who knows me, I'm very verbal. I have no qualms about voicing my opinion. I will find the facts. I will listen to my constituents, and I will bring their voice to city council. And I want everybody to look for FerraraFor15.com. on the 15 forward party line, that's the number 15. And I want them to know that they would choose me as their number one choice. And if you're not sure, put me as your number two. But number one or number two, I will be there. I will be side by side, working and listening and fighting for the things that they want to say. And I can answer them and say, when they say, what are you doing for me? I want to be able to be right there as Johnny on the spot and say, yeah, I'm doing that for you. I'm bringing that up. So I want them to remember that. And that is the honest truth.